Iba, ay, que canta el laberdo iba. Y en la verde oliva canta y
Hola, hola.
canta. ¿Qué pájaro será que canta en la verde oliva corre? Y dile que se calle, que es
Hola,
una
hola, 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 hola. Vale.
que se
Creo que le faltan
calle,
pilas.
que su cante me latina. Tú serás
Vale.
mi querida, tú serás mi cámara, tú serás el pájaro que alegre canta en la madrugada. Ay, que te quiero, loco.
Ahora sí.
¿Cuánto te quiero? Sin ti, mi vida, ¿pa' qué la quiero?
Hola, hola, hola. Hola, 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 hola.
Okay.
Hola, hola, hola. Hola, Carlson. Hola, Pablo.
Adoro, o pase. Ay, no lo pase por mi
Okay.
puerta, ay, por
Hola.
mi puerta,
Ahora no se oye,
adoro,
¿no?
o pase.
Hola, Carlson, ¿me oyes?
Ya yo he dicho
Sí, muy bien. Saludos.
Vale.
No
¿Qué
lo
has
pase
dicho?
por mi
Ah,
puerta.
saludos a ti también.
¿Por qué?
Okay, before starting, did you bring paper and a pencil, as I told you in the emails? No problem, you can use your phone also. I am going to put some music, okay? And some of the little parts of songs I am going to put, they are flamenco, and some of them, they are not. I'm going to put six little fragments, and you have to write down in the paper which ones you think are flamenco and which ones you think are not. And later we will see how the thing went. Okay? First one, eh? Everyone ready?
Mira la cara a cara que es la primera. Que es la primera. Mira la cara a cara que es la primera. Mira la cara a cara que es la primera.
Okay, second.
Ay, tonto, tontito, tonto, tonto, tonto.
Okay. Dale.
Ay. Mira qué bonito está el faro de la caleta de noche al lado.
Bueno.
Qué loco vive sin ella.
The last one. Okay. Who thinks the first one is flamenco? Who thinks the first one is not flamenco? Okay. 50%, more or less, okay? The second, who thinks it is flamenco? And not flamenco? Okay, all of you flamenco. Third one, yes, flamenco. And no flamenco? Two, no, three, no flamenco. Okay. 99%. Fourth one. Yes, flamenco. And no flamenco? Okay, 1%. Fifth one, yes, flamenco. No flamenco? 4%. And the last one, yes, flamenco. No flamenco? 50%. Okay. So, the only one that is on debate whether it is flamenco or not is the first one. All the rest are flamenco. More mainstream, less mainstream, but they are flamenco. So, what I was trying to do with this is to show you that flamenco is not just Sevillanas in the Feria de Abril in Sevilla, but it is rather a very heterogeneous musical tradition and culture, and just by that, it is super interesting. So, what have we done? This is a work in progress. It is in pre-print phase. So, basically, what we have done is a lexical investigation into flamenco styles. And I will explain to you now how we have done this. But what is flamenco? Well, flamenco is an oral musical tradition which is influenced by a lot of things, by the Jewish culture, Muslim culture, the Spanish folklore, and the culture, history, and traditions of Andalusian gypsies. But why is this? Why is this all so mixed? And why do these things contribute to flamenco? Well, as many of you may know, some of you may not know it, in Spain, it was in Spain, but now it is Spain, in the 15th century, the Jews were kicked out from our territory. And in the beginning of the 17th century, the Moors also were kicked out. So if you were either a Jew or a Moors and you wanted to still be here living, you have to be on the clandestinity without expressing that you were either a Jew or a Moors, okay? Gypsies come into play now because they arrived in 1425. Well, this is the first reference we have to the presence of gypsies in the Iberian Peninsula. Well, this is a very pretty curious data, no? But in 1425, Ferdinand V of Aragon authorized the entry to the Iberian Peninsula, to the part of his kingdom, to a set of Egyptians, which were gypsies, which carried a lot of things in carriages with horses, and they had a very brown skin, and they had a different language and strange ways of living. And that's how they referred to gypsies on that time. So we see how when both Jews and Moors were kicked out from the kingdom, gypsy people were already present here. What happened with gypsy people then? They were kicked out from a lot of countries. France, Sweden, Germany, England, Belgium, Portugal, and a lot of them. They were kicked out. They were not allowed to stay inside because they had these strange traditions and ways of living, no? What happened also with gypsies? They were obliged to be slaves. In Spain, in the 16th century, in Hungary and Romania, in the 18th century. In Spain, they were even condemned to extermination. As a proof of concept, the Marqués de la Ensenada, in 1749, developed a plan to exterminate the Gypsy race from Spain. Spoiler, it didn't work out. Gypsies continued to reproduce and to be present here. So Carlos III said, okay, let's not kill them. Let's rather alienate them. We are going to allow them to exist, but without being gypsies. So he published this Real something in 1783. And a very interesting point is that Caló, which is the Romani dialect of the gypsies in Spain, and Romani is the language that the gypsies speak, was prohibited. And yes? Ah, no, eso es porque, because I didn't change the camera, but the screen is being shared. Thank you, Emilio. Okay. So we have proofs of state councils of the 17th century in which the councillors said to the king, hey, there are some Moorish people that are living with the gypsies and are saying that they are gypsies, but they are not gypsies, they are Moorish, and we should kick them out. So we have this phenomenon here of different cultures living together and suffering together. And we see that in the lyrics of the flamenco songs. We will see it later. Okay, we saw more or less kind of how these different cultures and things influence flamenco, but when you go to see flamenco, what do you see? Well, because of these regulations and all of these things, the first reference to a flamenco gathering, to a gypsy party, is in 1793. This is not what we see today when we go to see flamenco. When we go to see flamenco, we see something like this. This is called a tablao, where a cuadro of people are doing a flamenco spectacle. We have three parts, the singing, the dancing, and the playing. Well, this dancer here is El Gillo. Some of you like him. I also like him. And this singing, dancing, and playing come together in different forms. These forms of flamenco are called palos, which are the styles of flamenco. We have more than five different palos. And one single palo can have geographical variations, can have personal variations, because some authors play them in different ways and all of that. And here flamenco is already very rich. So it is interesting because it is heterogeneous. It is also interesting because it is highly tied to history and tradition. And it is interesting because it is super diverse. These more than 500 different palos are differentiated by different features. The first one is the compás. The compás is the rhythm, and we have hundreds of different variations of compás in flamenco. These are the main ones, which are already a lot, but we can see the difference between two of them. This is the compás of the seguirillas. Okay, you follow this compás, and you can play seguirillas. And this is the compás of the fandango de Huelva, which is a little different. No, the first one was in technical words, the first one was an amalgamation of a 3/4 and a 6/8. And this is just a personalized way of 3/4 continuously. But this is not the only way in which different palos or styles of flamenco are differentiated. Each palo has its tonality, each palo has its melodies. And this is, why is this so different? Because each palo has its natural origin, its habitat, and its purpose. But I told you that not only people dance and play flamenco, they also sing it. And when you sing a song, hello, Juan.
Hello.
When you sing a song, you say things, no? You say words. What words do you see? What words do you say? What lexicon do you use when singing flamenco? This is what we said, okay, maybe. Because people haven't thought about this before. They haven't said, okay, can we study specifically and computationally what lexicon is used in flamenco lyrics? So based on this question, we formulate two main research questions. The first one is, can flamenco palos be classified solely by means of their lexicon? And if so, what is the characteristic lexicon of each palo? This is interesting because we already saw how flamenco is tied to history and tradition and how diverse it is. So if each palo has a different characteristic lexicon, each palo tells us different things about flamenco, and we will see later. And the second research question we made ourselves is, what relationships exist between the main flamenco palos based only on their lexicon? Okay, let's focus on the first question. To study this, what do we need? Lyrics. We need lyrics of flamenco, no? To analyze the contents of the lyrics, no? So we first look for lyrics. It is super complicated to find properly curated and very large amount of flamenco lyrics. It's not like pop or rock or reggaeton that you have the API of MusicXmatch or of Spotify and you find the lyrics. Here we have to use a hand transcribed lyrics corpus, which is available online in this website, and the author is called Norman and is very friendly. And the corpus is an agglutination of 78 different palos. The first thing we did when we took the corpus is to check what the NLP people, the natural language processing people, usually check in the corpus, no, of natural languages, which is these things. This thing is the Phipps law, which is a law that states that the frequency, the number of occurrences, the frequency of the usage of the words in a natural language text sufficiently large. If we order the words by the rank, it follows a power law with an exponent more or less one. Well, this is an error. This minus is already here, okay? And we find it more or less because you already know what happens with power laws, no? That power laws are everywhere, but they are not everywhere actually, okay? And the second law that we saw is the Phipps law. I mean, we are doing complex systems. Some power laws may arise. If not, this is not complex systems. The Phipps law. What is the Phipps law? This is more sophisticated, but it is super interesting. And it is used, well, I will tell you later when it is used. It relates the vocabulary size of a natural language text with the length of the text. What are those things? The vocabulary size is the number of unique words, like the dictionary. The dictionary of English or the dictionary of Spanish, for example, ideally has all the unique words that you can use when you speak Spanish, okay? And the length of a text is the actual number of words disregarding the repetition. I mean, if they are repeated, we count them, all the repetitions, in a text. So the brother of my brother is my brother has a lot of words. Brother appears 3 times, but in unique words, it has brother, the, of, my, is. And that's it, okay? So, this law, this empirical law, and there is debate whether this is called a law or not, but we will not talk about this. This empirical law states that this increase of the vocabulary size of a text with its length is sublinear. So it is it's a sublinear increase, and this is very useful when automatic classification models or text analysis machines or, for example, search engines have to estimate the vocabulary of a very large amount of text. Because they have the text, which is very large, and they need an estimation of the vocabulary size of the text, they can use this law. But with this corpus, we have a problem. You remember that I told you that this corpus agglutinates 78 palos, no? 78 different palos. So it is a diverse corpus. But only 8 of the 78 palos count on more than 100 lyrics. The rest of them are underrepresented. Like, this is already more than, less than 50 lyrics, and we have 58 more palos here. So we decided, as a proof of concept, as a first step, to analyze only the 8 most represented palos, which are these here. Bulerías, soleá, seguidillas, fandangos, tangos, tientos, malagueñas, and alegrías. Some of you already know about these words because I am always talking about these words, and also because I left in your tables surveys involving these words. So maybe it sounds for you. So what did we do? We take the full corpus and we reduce the corpus to take into account only these 8 palos. So we go from this to this. As we take only the most represented palos, the decrease in the number of lyrics we take into account is not so big. And well, the palos go from 78 to 8. The tokens, which is the amount of words, not unique words, the total amount of words, goes from 276,000 to 186,000. The types, which is the amount of unique words, is more or less the same. And the average types per song is more or less the same. So it is, in these statistical terms, it's representative of the full corpus, but of course we are leaving behind a lot of palos, but we can't take them into account because we don't have enough statistics. Okay, the first thing that we see is that in the distribution of the vocabulary of the lyrics, we already see differences between palos. What does this distribution mean? Well, this is the distribution of the amount of unique words in each of the lyrics of each palo. So we see that Bulerías, for example, has a lower vocabulary than Fandangos, but the distribution is wider, meaning, no, lower vocabulary than Fandangos, no, sorry, higher vocabulary than Fandangos, and the distribution is wider, meaning that the variety of vocabulary used in the songs of Bulerías is higher than the variety of vocabulary used in the songs of Fandangos. Okay, this is already a difference. It is a very boring difference, but it is a difference. Another metric that we use to characterize the corpus is the type to token ratio, which refers more or less to the lexical diversity of a text, or given a unique set of words, how many times these words are used, is if more or less are used the same, of two or three words are used way more than other words. This quantity accounts for this. And we already see a difference between the different palos. We see, like, comparing to the null model, some of them are above the null model, some of them are below the null model. This is another way of characterizing, again, a boring result, because this is not telling us anything about concrete, specific lexicon, but it already tells us, this combination already tells us that some palos are more diverse than others in terms of vocabulary. Okay? Now I'm going to present an unsolved question. We are debating about what this means. We don't know. Here we have what I just showed you, the type to token ratio, which is defined there. And we also calculated the entropy of the songs using the Shannon estimator. And it is the same. Well, not the same because the numbers are different, but you see, no? How they could be the same figure with different axes, no? More or less. Except for these two, but no? We don't know why this is, why this happens. We have been studying some expressions, some approximations, but we still don't understand this. So if any of you finds this interesting, maybe we can talk about this. Okay, because we don't know what this means. Okay, we already have the corpus. I have talked about the corpus a lot. Let's go to business. Let's go to analyze the corpus. We used a multinomial naive base, which is a very, very basic machine learning algorithm, a very, very basic classification model to classify texts. Okay? First, we have to prepare the data. Every data scientist knows that before analyzing the data, you have to prepare the data to get the results that you want to get, not for other things. So first, we filter the documents. What is filtering the documents? Well, it's taking out information that you don't want. For example, punctuation signs, accents, because these are hand-transcribed lyrics. The accents are not correct. Sometimes the words are not correctly accented, so we have to take the accents out. And the stop words, which is a very nice concept. Stop words are words that appear so much in all the texts that they don't give us information, maybe the articles, the determinants, and all of that. And in our analysis, we weren't interested in those words, so we took them. And then we compute the TF-IDF metric for each document for each word. What is this? This means term frequency and inverse document frequency, which basically computes for a document D and a word WB, the normalized frequency of the word WB in the document D, okay? But multiplied by a factor which penalizes this frequency if the word is very common in a lot of documents, for example, or increases this factor if the word is not so common in the other documents. Maybe it's not very common in these documents, but it doesn't appear in any other document. So that gives relevance to the word. We use this metric to characterize the words in the documents. So we have this matrix, and it has each row is a document, and each column is the TF-IDF value for the word given a document, okay? And we normalize these rows because we will see later that we can interpret this as a vector space and these documents are vectors, but we will see it later. Okay. So now we can use the multinomial naive Bayes. Why is it called Bayes? Because of the Bayes theorem. Is it said Bayes, Bayes, Bayes? I don't know, Bayes. Bayes gives us this expression. And well, you know, here will be the P of D, which is this is why this is proportional, and this is the prior probability of the class C. This is classification. This is the probability given a document D that the document pertains to the class C. Okay, and here we will have P given C, the probability of document D, but it is naive. It is naive because it is assuming independence of the appearance of the features. So we can decompose the conditional probability of document D given class C as a product of the conditional probabilities of each of the words in the vocabulary given a class C. Okay? And you say, what are these probabilities? They are given by this expression here, in which, well, basically it is the sum of the TF-IDF of the word WD in the document D for all the documents in the class C plus a factor alpha and normalized, okay? This factor alpha is a hyperparameter because it accounts for the zero frequency problem. Because if the TF-IDF is zero, this probability here is zero, and as the model is naive, then this would all be zero, and this will be zero, and we don't want zeros. So we sum something. And this something is alpha. And alpha may be between 0 and 1. Usually people put 1. But sometimes it's better to not put 1, to put something between 0 and 1. So we said, OK, let's see how this model behaves depending on different values of alpha. And we computed the accuracy, which we will see later what it is, but it is a measure of how well the model is behaving. We maximized it, and we chose this value of alpha. OK? With this value of alpha, the accuracy of prediction of Palos of this model for unknown lyrics is given by this figure. Look to seguidillas. It's almost 100%. Like the model has learned what a seguidilla is, only reading seguidillas lyrics. Because I haven't sung seguidillas to the model. It has only read lyrics. Alegrías, soleá, bulerías, fandangos, malagueñas. This is very nice. This is not so nice, but it has an explanation. We will see later. But this is very nice. Do you agree that this is very nice? Okay. So we have already answered the first part of the research question one, which is, can we differentiate between different flamenco palos solely by their lyrics? Yes, we don't, but the multinomial naive Bayes does. Well, can, I don't know. Okay. These accuracies are computed, these are distribution computed over a lot of realizations of trainings and validations and all of that. Let's see one single training, one arbitrary training. This is the confusion matrix. What we see here is that the palos are correctly predicted in most of the cases, but some of them are highly confused. What is a confusion? When the model, given a true Boolerias lyrics, says that it is not Boolerias, but it is rather a solea. But it is not a solea, it is a Boolerias. But the model says it is a solea. This is a confusion. We have confusions between solea and Boolerias. We have confusions between fandangos and malagueñas. We have confusions between tangos and tientos, a lot of confusions. These confusions are super interesting. Why? Because the model doesn't know anything about music, history, or flamenco. It only knows about lyrics. But without knowing, it is already telling us that Boolerias and solea are somehow related. And they are, because Boolerias come from the acceleration of the end of the Soleas, 1 century ago. Another connection. Fandangos and Malagueñas. The model doesn't know about it, but Malagueñas are a regional variation of Fandangos. And this is very interesting because there are several historical theories about the relationship between Fandangos and Malagueñas. Some of them say that Malagueñas and Fandangos are not so related. Some of them say that they are related. But these are theories without data. I mean, these are theories constructed by people who read 3 lyrics, write 10 books, and then develop a theory. Here, a model reads thousands of lyrics. We write, we don't write books. We don't sell nothing. We pay for publishing. And then we retrieve this data. And tientos and tangos is the most amazing confusion. It is a very high confusion. But es que the truth is that tientos come from tangos. Because less than a century ago, Antonio Chacón, to which the album that I put you in the beginning was a homage to, developed a new kind of tangos, which was slower than tangos, because tangos are festive and fast, and tientos are very slow. And he used a lot the word tiento. So when people reproduced these styles, they called them tientos. And the model is already seeing this. The model doesn't know about Antonio Chacón, but it knows that somehow they are related. No? This is why the accuracy in predicting tangos and tientos was so low, because for the model, they are the same, because they are the same. Okay? Let's go back to what we saw, the conditional probability of a word W given a class C. Because the second part of our research question was, one, was, if so, what is the characteristic lexicon of each palo? For that, we will take each palo, which is each class C, and we will compute the conditional probability for each word W in our vocabulary given a palo C. Okay? So the words with higher probability, with higher conditional probability, are more characteristic of this palo because they allow the model to identify that palo. If we compute it, we see something like this. We compute it over several realizations of training and validation and all of these machine learning things. And we see this thing. If we rank the words by their probability, well, we use the logarithm because they are normalized probabilities and we are talking about 50,000 words. So the probabilities are 0.000 something. So we use the logarithm, it's better. And in fact, this is called log probability. And I think the machine learning people talk a lot about log probability. I don't know. And we rank them by the mean log probability of each word over a lot of realizations. Here, I think I remember it where they were 100 realizations. We see this distribution. Here, we find this stop and then continue at a minimum value because here the vocabulary is, these words here are not inside the palo alegrías. Are words of our vocabulary of the corpus, but these words are not inside any alegría. So the probability is always the minimum. Okay, we see that for all the palos. Similar form, different words. Now let's see which are the characteristic words of each palo. No? What do we do? How many words do we take? The 100 most characteristic words. Why? Why 100? Why not 200? Why not 50? Why not 10? And it is super easy. So we develop a concept. This concept is called essential words. What are essential words? Well, if we do a lot of realizations and we have this distribution, there will be realizations here in the minimum value, which are actually from words that are inside the alegrías. But sometimes in the training dataset, they don't appear. So they go to zero. Okay, as we rank them with the mean log probability, we go to the first word that appears in the minimum probability. The first one. And from that word to here, we have the essential words. They are the words that are always relevant for any training set of alegrías that we take. They are always relevant, super relevant. And these are the essential words. And we compute these essential words over several realizations, and each palo has a different number of essential words. So it wasn't a very good idea to say, okay, the first 10 most characteristic words of each palo. because we see that Soleá has like almost 200 essential words and malagueñas less than 20. Okay? As we see, we see the same. You have to believe me because I didn't put the names. Well, even if I put the names, you would have to believe me. But these are the 8 different palos, okay? Let's go to 2 of them, alegrías and segrillas. We obtain these things. These are alegrías and these are segrillas. Alegrías are, there are, well, the history, these history studies that I told you about, they say that alegrías come from a dynamization of the Aragonese Jotas. And they were originated in Cádiz during the French invasion in the beginning of the 19th century. So it is not surprising to find Cádiz as the first characteristic word of alegrías. We find Cádiz, Muralla Real, which is a part of Cádiz. More things about Cádiz. San Fernando is a neighborhood of Jerez de la Frontera, which is in. Yes. And we see other words. Other words that you say, well, contigo, mandilón, mandilón. Well, mandilón, some of you are not Spanish speakers. Mandilón, I didn't know what it was before making this analysis. Cuando, which is when, llaman, they call, voy, I go, dirá. Why are these words so relevant? Navarra, yes, because there is, we will talk about Navarra later. Because these words are very strange, no? You see these words and you say, why are these words so characteristic if they are not telling me anything, no? Let's go to seguirillas. In seguirillas, the thing changes because the first word are mother, God, heart, soul, freedom, desgracia, which is like disgrace, pains, freedom, well, I already said freedom, death, hospital, Santiago, which is a neighborhood of, but Santiago is always present, fatigas, which is fatigues, pains, sorrows, well, these things, no? But we also see other things that we say, because the word that I just told you may be like profound, sentimental, religious. But why is there here clavo? Clavo is clove. Why is the plant? Is the plant? I will tell you later. It's not the, it's the plant. Clavo. I don't know. Clavo, for example. Compañera, okay, compañera. Llamaban, they were calling. These words are part of what are called fossilized structures. This is a very interesting concept that we will see later, because now I didn't remember, but first I was going to talk to you about 4 main lexical fields in which we see variation between palos. For example, the first one, geography and daily life. Titirimundis, which is puppet show. It is a very characteristic, super characteristic word of alegrías. Why? Because they appear a lot in a fossilized structure. We will see later. Corte, court, capital, Madrid, is very characteristic of malagueños. Cádiz, of alegrías, we already saw, no? Geography, places, Muralla Real, Barrio de San Fernando, all of these things. Gypsy, family, and culture. Well, gypsies are super present in flamenco. Gitano, gypsy, primo, causing, because you say causing, maybe causing is not gypsy, but it is always in a gypsy environment, in a gypsy lexical environment. For those of you who are not Spanish speakers, primo is very gypsy. Primo, prima, these things. And caló lexicon. You remember that I told you that caló is the dialect of the Romani language of Spain. There are some palos which are associated to the gypsy culture and history in which caló lexicon appears. Well, as an essential word, eh? This is not only that it appears, but it appears essentially. Deep feelings, pain, sorrow, I adore, love, and abstract concepts like forgiveness, soul, freedom, and God. This is already interesting because flamenco is not always not only talking about ole, viva Sevilla. No, a lot of things. Flamenco is called sapiential music because it's not just folklore and celebration and all that. No, no, it's telling history. It is very tied to culture and tradition, and this is a proof of that. But I will put more music. Formulaic expressions. Ah, because I said fossilized expressions. No, yes. But David told me that fossilized expression is a bad translation from Spanish, formula fossilizada. In English, it is called formulaic expressions. Well, a formulaic expression is a combination of words that appears generation after generation without a proper, a coherent and cohesive meaning with the rest of the text. Flamenco doesn't have a traditional song structure in which you read the lyrics, you read a story, and flamenco tells you something. No, it is just an agglutination of a lot of stanzas and verses without any connection between them. Very chaotic, very difícil, very crazy. And these verses are formulaic expressions. For example, in Tientos, we can find this one, which says, I will let Miguel Poveda tell me first.
E inmediato allí en aquel posito inmediato
in that immediate little web
donde vende mi palo
where my boat is. Disartiendo su teatro.
Yo me paro.
Ahí está, Ter. Yo me paro. Ahí está.
Ay, yo me paro y me
pierdo.
Ay, que por ver.
Tú sí, de Little Water. De todos. Arting, sí. Ok. This tells us a story. But this is maybe just next to a verse in which he's saying that he went to Cádiz and he saw his mother was dead. Something like that. Okay, this is all in the same lyrics. Nothing has to do with nothing. These are formulaic expressions. So we find these characteristic words that I told you later. Oh, why is this here? This has no meaning. This makes no sense. It is because these formulaic expressions.
This verse appears in many songs.
Yes, this is, well, they appear a little different. For example, sometimes they say el agua, sometimes they say la agüita. Instead of paro, maybe they say me levanto, something like that. But the form is the same and the essential words are the same for all the tientos. And in alegría we find... Yes, yes, yes. In different songs about different things, we find this structure. This and many others. Those verses in slightly variations, but with the same essential words, like pocito, inmediato, agua, agüita, palomas, they appear. And why are they essential? Because this form is repeated in a lot of tientos. And not only is it repeated, but it serves to the multinomial naive base for identifying tientos, which is what makes it essential.
Can we find this in another part? These verses?
No, these verses, no. Because it is a formulaic expression of tientos. Maybe in some tangos, for example, because they are very connected. But normally, the essential words of a palo are not found, in the majority of cases, in other palos. Some of them they are, because they are very common words like verbs, flexions, and all of that. But pocito and inmediato, pocito, little well, little water, these are for tientos. And in alegrías, we have another example. Of course, I put another musical. And here she says, this is very musical for my alegrías. They start from the second verse. If I don't see you, what is happening? When I see you, I feel sad. But if I don't see you, I feel sad. And I don't feel more joy than when they mention your name to me. this, maybe they see it, they say this. Vale. Maybe they say this after they have been talking about the beauty of the Royal Wall of Cádiz. So it is not coherent, but it is essential. So we have already answered the second part of the first research question. What is the characteristic lexicon of each part? Now we go to the second research question, which is, what relationships exist between the main flamenco palos based on their lexicon? Because now we have a lot of lyrics for each palo. So how can we compute interrelationships between palos? We thought we need a distance. We will compute a distance between palos, but we don't have palos per se. We have songs, and these songs are classified in palos. So what we do is to aggregate all of the songs of the same palo into a single palo document. So imagine if the palo complex is made of these songs, of these lyrics, ay, 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 ole li fisk, guapos gitanos. Here we have a single document with all the lyrics aggregated, and this is the document for the palo complex. Okay? We do it with the 8 palos that we are analyzing, and we compute the cosine distance between these documents. But how do we compute the cosine distance? What is this? What is this here? Well, if you remember, when I explained you the 10 frequency inverse document frequency metric, I told you that the representation in the word space of each document was a normalized vector. So here we have the vectors. If we have 50,000 words in our vocabulary, we have a 50,000 dimensional space, and each document is a vector, and we can compute dot products between these 50,000 dimensional vectors, which sounds like string theory, but it is flamenco. And we find these amazing results. If we compute the cosine distance between different palos and we plot a network, because we are doing physics of complex systems, we need networks apart from power loss, we find this. We see that Alegrías is far away from the rest of the palos, and some palos are, because the size of the nodes is their closeness centrality. So some palos, the weighted closeness centrality, weighted by the distance. Some palos are like more central, no? Bulerías, for example, Soleás, Tangos and Tientos are super close, these things, no? We can see it more clearer here in this matrix representation, in which we can find how clusters are formed. No? We have a cluster between, this is hierarchical clustering, basic hierarchical clustering. And we can see how Tangos and Tientos are in a cluster, Soleás and Bulerías are in another cluster, and Alegrías are very far away from the rest of the palos. So what information can we retrieve from this? First information, the maximum cosine distance between two palos is 0.7. Even though the metric is defined between 0 and 1. So there are no palos that are totally far away. There is a little proximity, at least, between all the palos. We can also see these clusters here that maybe tell us something about relationships between palos that can support or the contrary, not support, which I don't remember the word now. What is the contrary of supporting? Not supporting. They cannot support historical theories or something like that. But there is something interesting we can do that I learned what it was very little ago, which is the spanning trees, the minimum spanning tree of this network. This happened. What is the minimum spanning tree? Well, it is a spanning tree in which it is a connected network without cycles. And the minimum spanning tree is the spanning tree in which the sum of distances that we have here is minimum. And we have it here. Why is this interesting? Because we have a branch here with Seguirillas and Soleás. Seguirillas and Soleás are believed to be the most primitive and gypsy palos. In fact, their lyrics use a lot of Kalo lexicon. They are believed to be this, and they are not obviously related in some way, but here we find them related, okay, because of their lexicon. Here we have the malagueñas and the fandangos in another branch. We already were imagining that because the model confuses them a lot, no? Because they are like parents, already supporting theories that say they are parents and not supporting theories that say that they are not parents. This is the tangos and tientos branch, which I already explained you before, how they are connected. And the alegrías, I don't know why, are like separated. And the bulerías are the nexus that connect all of them. And this is very beautiful because bulerías is like the palo that all the gypsies know how to sing, how to dance. They use them in celebrations. For example, if you see on the street gypsies singing and dancing, 99.99% that they are dancing bulerías or singing bulerías because it is the festive palo por excelencia. I don't know how to say that in English. So this is question two, answer, and I am finishing. Conclusions. This is a proof of concept. Okay, and for that, to answer questions, research questions one and two, we use a very simple classification model for text analysis, and we obtain our results. These results have limitations. For example, they are highly corpus dependent. If we change the corpus, the distributions of the songs, and we take another corpus, the conclusions may be different. And they are highly dependent on the filtering process. For example, if we don't take out the stopwords add a lot of noise and contaminate a lot the results because they are per se relevant, because they appear a lot and they are needed to the communication process, no? But we are not interested in them. So how reliable is this? It would be interesting to perform a temporal evolution analysis, but for that, we need more data. We need lyrics from a lot of times, and we don't have them because flamenco, unfortunately, at least for me, is like a niche music nowadays, and we don't have that amount of information that we actually have from other genres, more standard, like blues, hip-hop, jazz, and, well, jazz, rock, pop, all of this. And I propose you to visit a tablao sometime. Here in Palma, we didn't have a good tablao until now, because there is a new tablao that opened in Avenidas. It is called Tablao Alma, and you can already go there. I haven't gone, so this is not a recommendation. This is a suggestion. Now, to finish, I have two bonus. The first bonus is a reflection by Manuel Molina, which is already dead flamenco singer and guitar player. And it is in Spanish, but I can translate it later. But I will.
Y los arreglos, y todo está pasado por las máquinas. El otro día llegué a un sitio que no voy a decir con quién y estaban grabando. Y desafinaba, el protagonista desafinaba y le decía el ingeniero: no te preocupes, ahora lo arreglo yo en la mezcla. Y el otro, un fallo. No te preocupes, ahora cuando mezclemos lo arreglo yo. Y me levanto y digo, bueno, tío, aquí cuando coño se dice ole.
Okay, he's making criticism for the non-Spanish speakers. He's saying like, he goes to a recording studio and the people who are recording music perform very badly and the recorder say, don't worry, I fix it later in the computer. And then he says, and when do we say ole? Like, what kind of shit is this, no? So I went to an artificial intelligence and I created a flamenco song from zero, from scratch, without doing anything. Like this recorder that Manuel Molina was complaining about, now it's artificial intelligence called Suno, which was recently bought by Microsoft. And I just told the artificial intelligence, compose a flamenco song about Ifisk, about the work that I am doing with Maxi and David, and mention Rosalía. And this is the result.
En el Ifisk Park, Si David un sueño te dirá, con léxico y ritmo salía a mirar, con léxico la ciencia en Mallorca, nuevo lenguaje.
Ayer me quise confundir por el hecho. No, Morsi. Ok, muchas gracias. I am sorry because this was very long, but I wanted to say a lot of things. So. Which part? I don't know. Well, I can send the algorithm the lyrics and let's say what the algorithm says.
But that's fake. You didn't play the original one.
No, it's because before this one I made another one. But that one I only sent to David and Maxi because it's funnier. It was some cebolleta character, right? So, questions, compliments, suggestions, complaints. Wait.
Is there a similar style for the kinds of music?
Yes, for pop, music, rock, Taylor Swift,
yeah.
German folkloric songs of a lost region, but not for flamenco.
I was going to ask that if you could think that you could use your framework with other kind of, I don't know, folkloric music, maybe that are very, like, for example, blues that is very linked to the history of the States.
Yes.
Or there is something unique about flamenco in which the léxico is more important than in other music styles.
This multinomial night bass is, I mean, this is a standard. Our innovation or the interesting part of our work is not the use of multinomial night bass. Of course, multinomial night bass have been used in blues, rock, pop, there is a very famous work about Taylor Swift, which was published in April Fool, but it is actually very interesting. And what is unique about flamenco is this thing that I told you about the formulaic expressions. Because if you analyze that, you can do, for example, topic modeling on blues lyrics or rock lyrics. In flamenco, normally you can't, because these topics are very strange, because there are no topics. I mean, what kind of topic is little well, doves, immediate? It's super strange, but this is because they are formulaic expressions. So as a first step, we use this multinomial night bass because it's very easy to understand what it is doing. The results are very, the level of interpretation of the results is super high, but maybe with other algorithms, deep learning and all of this, which the interpretation is lower, but they work nicer in other music styles, we could see some interesting things in flamenco, so I don't know.
And then I know that you focus on the lexico and the language, and the words, but did you think of what kind of information would you get if you cross your data with like data coming from the instrumental part of the song? Like, because you could also process the song, I guess there is software from which you can get the things like the rhythm or things like that, like digitalize the song and process the data.
That already exists because this is called like computational flamenco, and between 5 and 10 people in the world do it. They are all in Spain. They are between Andalucía and the Pompeu Fabra in Catalonia. And they are like music information retrieval from the computational, of course it's computational, but they didn't focus in the lyrics. They did what you said. For example, they looked at a huge corpus of 10,000 flamenco songs and they analyzed the rhythm, the compás. And they saw these patterns, they saw how the seguirillas compás and the bulerías compás are parented. Also that they found melodic patterns across history. But these songs are not transcribed. We don't have the lyrics. Mm-hmm. If we had the lyrics of those songs, we could do like some crossing, no? And see, but we don't have them. And we are not going to transcribe 10,000 lyrics by hand. And the first time we were planning this research, we used OpenAI's model Whisper. But it worked horribly because we talked with the Pompeu Fabra researchers and we asked them for their corpus and they sent us their huge corpus and we used this whisper by OpenAI, but it worked. It was fatidic. It was horrible because flamenco songs, they have this characteristic, no? Their dialect is super regional of Andalucía. These models are usually, unfortunately, not trained on rural dialects of Spain, of Spanish. And the model performed, and there is a lot of melisma, the model performed horrible.
Okay, thank you very much. Very nice talk.
Thank you for the question.
In all the clouds of words you have shown us, there were real words, but do you consider also words like ay, ole, alza,
yes,
these kind of things?
Yes, in fact, words like ay and ole, these kind of words are in the stop words list because they appear a lot. Like I think, right now I don't remember, but I think ay is not in the stop words, but ole is, because ole is present in all the lyrics. In fact, some lyrics from Seguirillas are ay 30 times, but no more, because it's flamenco is a music which is more like a feeling, no? You don't go to a flamenco spectacle to think about, oh, yes, he's talking about the Royal Wall in Cádiz. That was built in 1840. No, you just go to feel what they do, and sometimes with ay, 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 people cry just hearing to ay, ay, ay. So those are the lyrics, ay, ay, ay.
I was about to ask this precise question, but I will pose another one. So you stated very strongly at the beginning of your talk what flamenco is, but I know many people, many gypsies, that will argue what flamenco is. My question is also related to what Javi asked. There has been a lot of innovations and changes in flamenco recently, and there are some like very classical albums of changes. There are also changes in the lexicon. You mentioned that there is a problem with the amount of data and the historical data, but do you notice if there, with the appearance of Rosalía or, for instance, La Leyenda del Tiempo with Camarón, if there are, have been changes in the lexicon of flamenco?
That is a very interesting question, but we can't solve that question with our corpus, because we are dependent on what this guy decided to transcribe during his life. And these songs, we don't have the recording date of the vast majority of the songs. We just have the year of birth and the year of death, if the singer is dead, of the singers of the songs. So these are mainly songs from the first half of the 20th century, and some of them from the second half of the 20th century. So Rosalía is not here. Maybe La Leyenda del Tiempo could be inside this corpus in time sense, but it is not. So we can't, as we don't have reliable information about the like a temporal, a time series of these lyrics, we cannot make that kind of analysis. In fact, that was one of the outlooks I said in the end, because that would be super interesting, because I am sure this song that I put you in the beginning, which was some bulerías saying tonto, tontito, tonto, these bulerías, if you listen to it as a whole, it talks about coronavirus, as a guy that ate a bat, and then we all went into a pandemic, something like that. And that is not what Antonio Chacón sang in the Vientos. It is, of course, the lexicon has changed, but we are not able to analyze it with this corpus. With this method, we could do it. In fact, it has been done in other text corpus, but with our corpus, it's not possible.
Okay, thank you.
So I have a question about the confusion matrix, because I noticed it's not like extremely symmetric. Does this imply like some sort of, I don't know, directionality, or what do you think is causing it? No, the confusion matrix.
Ah, sorry, yes.
See.
It's not symmetric because of this. It's easier to confuse a Malagueña with a Fandangos, that a Fandangos with a Malagueña. Because you are better trained in Fandangos. Also, we don't know how Tientos, Malagueñas, and Alegrías are related, and how these things could affect how Tientos are misunderstood as tangos, or the other way around. It's something that happens, but the explanation, at least up to now, what we think is happening, is this this discrepancy on the representation of the... Because we could say that if we all had the same quantity of all the palos, this anti-symmetry wouldn't be present, but we don't know. Maybe when we train the model, we could say, okay, let's train the model with the same quantity of all the palos. But then in the validation, what quantity do we choose? Because if we have to have training set and validation set for all the palos, and we train with the same quantity, what quantity do we choose? Like 50 lyrics to have training and validation of all the palos and the same quantity for all of them? 50 lyrics is very little. What we could do is to take all the alegrías, for example, and then take the same quantity of alegrías for all of the rest of palos and train with that. But then how do we validate alegrías? It's difficult. So the answer we have as of today is that this is the cause of the anti-symmetry of the confusion matrix. But we don't know. No, yeah, Pablo, yes.
I can ask more things, but I was wondering at the end, I mean, I suppose that there exists a bulería, archetypical bulería, no? But I suppose also that there are many things between different palos, no? At the end, for example, between bulería and soleá, you have this.
Yes, between bulería and soleá, you have bulerías al golpe, bulerías por soleá.
So at the end, I mean, this classification of palos, how strict it is, how... I mean, I don't know if, I suppose there's people studying this, but I don't know if, I mean, probably there's things in between, no? There are a lot of grays between one palo and
yes.
the other.
Yes.
Have you tried to put all your songs in the model and try to see if the palos it gets, just from the study of all the data, the classification of clusters or things, have something to do with the palos that people are have classified already? I don't know if I'm explaining myself.
I don't know if I understood.
You have all your corpus.
You could
try to, for all these songs, for all these lyrics, try to get your own different palos, no? Somehow.
Yes, to perform unsupervised clustering.
Yes.
No? Yes, we tried. We tried with K-means. We tried with K-medoids or something like that. We tried with... I always forget the letters, but it is this deep learning thing that was you in 2D clusters and all of that. I don't remember the... Yes, but also is VM or something. I don't know. A lot of letters, which is deep learning. And we don't find interesting clusters. We think, again, it is because of very low statistics. Mm-hmm. But we don't know. The first try was with K-means, and it was super deceiving. In fact, I remember last year, it was the first loop we did to the corpus, and it was like, there is nothing here. But it is because maybe we have very little statistics to perform unsupervised learning. Mm-hmm. Or maybe we don't know how to perform unsupervised learning, which is also possible.
Okay, thank you.
And regarding the first part of your question, of course, this is a continuum. It's like dialects. This is a continuum. Because what some people say are bulerías, some people say that, no, they are actually soleá por bulerías. No, this is a bulerías al golpe. No, this is bulerías de Jerez. No, but this is the Triana. We did an epistemological analysis, and we took as true what Norman Paul Kliman said in cantetoque.es. This is our truth. Like this faith dogma. No, this is our dogma. The Holy Trinity, this is our Holy Trinity.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming.
Gracias.
Gracias.